Now let's learn about Kerala. Kerala is a state on India's tropical Malabar coast. It has nearly 600 kilometers of the Arabian Sea shoreline. It is known for its palm-lined beaches and backwaters and a network of canals. It is located on the southwest corner of a country and it is surrounded by sea on one side and hills on another side. Inland are the Western Ghats, mountains whose slope support tea, coffee, and spice plantations as well as wildlife. Kerala is known as the spice garden of India because of the variety of spices it delivers to the nation. Located between Lakshadweep Sea and the Western Ghats, Kerala is considered to be one of the peaceful and cleanest states of India. A number of spices like pepper, cloves, and cardamom are grown on the hills. It is the spices that made this region an attractive place for traders. Both Jewish and Arab traders were the first to come here. On your screen, on your right-hand side, you will see a picture of some of the spices we can get from Kerala. Let's know more about Kerala. It is believed that the apostle, which means an important Christian teacher, St. Thomas, came to Kerala 2000 years ago, and because of him, many people in Kerala follow Christianity. The tradition of origin among St. Thomas Christians relates to the arrival of St. Thomas, one of the 12 disciples of Jesus, at the ancient seaport Muziris on the Kerala coast in 52 AD. There is an influence of other cultures in Kerala too. Many Arab traders came and settled down here. The Portuguese discovered the sea road to India from Europe when Vasco da Gama landed with his ship here. Because of all these various historical influences, people in Kerala practice different religions such as Judaism, Islam, Christianity, Hinduism, and Buddhism. The cuisine of Kerala, a state in the south of India, is linked to its history, geography, demography, and culture. Kerala's cuisine offers a multitude of both vegetarian and non-vegetarian dishes, prepared using fish, poultry, and red meat with rice. People in Kerala prefer eating fish since it's located on the coast. Apart from that, they eat rice and vegetables too. The fertile land and climate here are suited for growing rice. The picture you see on your screen is that of Chinese fishing nets, also called chinawala, are a type of stationary lift net in India. They are fishing nets that are fixed land installations for fishing. While commonly known as Chinese fishing nets in India, the more formal name for such nets is shore-operated lift nets. This way of fishing is unusual in India and almost unique to the area, as it was introduced by Chinese explorers who landed there in the 14th century. We know that both Kerala and Ladakh are different states located in different directions in our country. But even though they are different in terms of their geographical features, the history is quite similar. Both regions were influenced by Chinese and Arab traders. The spices of the Kerala and the wool of Ladakh attracted traders. So quite often, the history and geography are linked to the cultural life of a region. So now that we've understood that Kerala and Ladakh are two different states, but they still have a lot of similarities, let's understand what is unity in diversity in India. India is a country of many diverse cultures, religions, food, habits, wildlife, flora and fauna, that is plants and wildlife, festivals, dances, etc. This is due to the migration of people in search of new land or for a better future. If you think about it, we do many things that are similar, except that we do them in different ways. Let's take another example of the harvest season. We all know that India relies on agriculture to feed its large population, and farming is India's main occupation. The 28 states of India celebrate its own harvest festival at various times throughout the year. Major harvest festival in India is Makar Sankranti, which is also known as Pongal, Uttrayan, Lohri, Posh Prabhun, Bhogali, Bihu in different parts of our country. The same festival is celebrated in different states in different ways. Let's understand what effect the diverse cultures have in the present era. Our present lives are all about moving from place to place for work and for other reasons. Because of this, we carry our culture and traditions to the land we move to. For example, if you look around you, you will see that your neighbors may be from different parts of the country, or that some of your friends or relatives may have settled in other parts of the country. This is how our traditions are affecting each other's lives. We have been using the term unity in diversity in our video again and again. Let's know who first coined this term. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India, coined the phrase unity in diversity. He meant that in spite of different languages, religion and food habits, there is unity in India. The interdependence of communities on each other forges a link of bond and unity. He came up with this term to describe our country, which in spite of being diverse with many languages, there is a feeling of oneness among people. He used this phrase in his book Discovery of India. Our first Prime Minister said, "It was something deeper and within its fold. The widest tolerance of belief and custom was practiced and every variety acknowledged and encouraged." It means that people of India, even though they are different from each other, they practice different religions, different lifestyles, but they accept everyone as they are and they acknowledge the fact, respect and encourage each other. Did you know that during our freedom struggle with the British, people from different cultural, religious and regional backgrounds came together to fight and ask them to go back? Our motherland was the only reason that brought them together. The British thought that they could divide and rule us, but Indians once again proved them wrong. They united and asked the British to quit India. The people of India showed them that the British were wrong. They could neither divide us nor could they rule us. And that is how, during a freedom struggle, many freedom fighters from different backgrounds, different financial backgrounds, different religious backgrounds came together and fought for our freedom. In fact, during our freedom struggle, different songs were composed in different languages and sung. Symbols were made that reminded of our country's rich tradition. They constantly reminded people that even though there could be differences within us, we should be united for a common cause, that is freedom from the British. So you will see that every state has a freedom fighter, and these freedom fighters are still recognized, respected, and remembered for their contribution to our freedom struggle. So it is when the whole of India came together that is when we could achieve the freedom from the British Empire. To sum up, in the ancient times, man was a nomad, meaning he didn't have a permanent place to live in. It was only years later that he started living a social life by mixing with other people of the society. This made man a social animal. People cannot fulfill all their needs on their own. We depend on each other and also on the social groups to fulfill our needs. That is how we understand diversity. The background, such as religion, social status, economic status, cannot become barriers in making friends. Inequality comes only when a person does not have the resources and opportunities that are available to other persons. This is what we will discuss in the next chapter. But this is how diversity began. Thank you very much for listening. The end.